Hi, Sasha here from Casually Comics, and I am salty. And so I'm going to, this video is part vent, part test. So let me explain. If you follow the community posts, slash if YouTube notifies you about them, you'll know that my recent-ish video about Robin, Damian Wayne, and the new character from his solo series, Flatline, was age-restricted. No explanation, just you wake up in the morning and it's 18 plus. Now, what that means when a video is made 18 plus, they say it doesn't matter, but it 100% does. Because what it does is it changes the ad tier. And when that happens, it just completely gets rid of your video being seen by people, which is the part that bothers me because I am fond of that video. I think it's good. I think it's a fun introduction to the character. And also the thing that bothers me is that I know that there's nothing 18 plus worthy inside of that video because that comic is very much a, even calling it teen would be kind of intense. It's very much a PG rated Mortal Kombat style tournament. There's really nothing there that warrants like, whoa, you need to sneak into this theater to see this. It's too much. The thing with the age restriction on YouTube, which I'm sure you've heard from other creators because this is not a unique thing that's happened to me, is they don't tell you why. So you just get a mysterious email, like I did. It's not mysterious, it's from them. Like, woo, so mysterious. So here it is. So this came in at 2:17 in the morning, so there was nothing I can do about it. So for hours, this was just sitting there. But it says, hi, Casually Comics. We have reviewed your content. Who? Doesn't say. Person bought. Probably a bot, and have determined that may not be suitable for viewers under the age of 18 per our community guidelines. Which guidelines? There are a lot of guidelines. I'm familiar with them, but they don't say which. So you don't know. Is it too violent? Is it too sexy? Is it too, because I know it's none of those things. So at least if I knew what they were targeting, do they not like that it says she'll rip your heart out in the thumbnail? Like anything would be something that you can then go and say, okay, well, let me change that, even if I think it's nonsense. Let me see if there's something I can do about that, and then I can avoid that for the future. If it was that kind of claim, because sometimes your video can get age restricted because salty people flag it, and I can see that happening. This is tinfoil hat conspiracy theory time, but it could be because some people thought this video was about Tim, that this was somehow about Tim Drake, because there are multiple Robins running around calling themselves Robins, so it's not entirely a baseless assumption. So some of them were angry and they're like, oh, so is this some kind of shot against Bernard and that relationship? So I'm like, maybe that. Some people didn't like that Flatline seemed older than him, or that it dethroned Robin and Raven. There are lots of people do anything on the internet. Who knows why, if somebody felt salty that day, they could flag it. Who knows? I will never know because YouTube does not tell you. So I went to the proper channels. I submitted the appeal. Within 6 minutes of sending that email, my video is 16 minutes long. They claimed that I have the email. Hold on. Now it's 7:51 a.m. 6 minutes after I submitted this claim. We have reviewed your appeal for the following. We reviewed your content carefully and have confirmed that it violates our community guidelines. We know this is probably disappointing news, but it is our job to make sure that YouTube is a safe place for all. That's why we leave up all the animal murder videos and the prawn from all through the ages and all that stuff. We leave that up, but this Flatline video is too much. Could it be that her name is Flatline? Could it be something that simple? Like, you have to tell me. So that's there. So there are a couple things there. One, it's still ridiculous because the video is obviously not 18 plus worthy. And two, there's no way a human reviewed it in that time. That was a bot. And if it was a human, there's no way they actually looked at it. And it could have just been it shows up on the person's screen. Okay, I'm just upholding it because I don't want to deal with it or I have other things to do. And this creator isn't big enough to make enough noise. So I did send it to my YouTube rep and hopefully maybe she can do something with it just because it annoys me on principle because it makes no sense. Like some of the more corporate videos, music videos and the like, they play by different rules. So the fact that they're not age restricted when some of them very much should be is unsurprising. But the way it's applied to regular creators is very random. And that's why sometimes you have all these theories that will pop up as to like, oh, it's targeting certain people and certain things and da da da. And I can see where that comes from, because there's no rhyme or reason to it. The bot is out of control. It's been programmed to be like a Helena Lovejoy pearl-clutching bot. I have no idea what it's looking for. And nobody does. And that's the problem, because then you can't properly cater your content or play by any kind of rules, because you don't know what the rules are. They're there on paper, but then, or rather digitally, but they don't tell you which ones they are. So for me, the frustration is the fact that this so obviously makes no sense, and the video was doing well. And when this happens, it very much just cuts that off, and it can be seen as a detriment to your channel, despite the fact that they say that it isn't, but it is. One of those, like, your parents, like, we're not mad, we're just disappointed. Now, go to your room, all of your stuff is gone. So I wanted to make this video also partially as a test. After I'm done this intro part, I'm going to re-upload the rest of that Robin video. I think it's a good video, and I think it's worth seeing. And with the age restriction in place, a lot of people just aren't going to see it because it's no longer going to be recommended to people. And not only that, the viewers who are under 18 aren't going to be able to watch it. And for what? This girl, she looked like she wore too much Hot Topic. We cannot have that. I want to see a couple of things. Will YouTube allow it to go up again? Or is, like, is it something intrinsic to the thing it says? Because, like, your videos are reviewed when they go up initially. And if there's anything suggestible in the tag or the title or the thumbnail, it's reviewed by a person at that time. Mine had already gone through that review. You can see what type of reviews your videos go through. Mine had already gone through that first person, and so that was fine, which leads me to believe that it was a manual flag. So I'm curious. I'm like, will it happen again? And will I ever get a response from YouTube as to why it was flagged? I would just like to know. Even if it is something as ridiculous as, oh, it says she'll rip your heart out. That's so violent. That's 18 plus violent. And the other reason is I am salty. I am salty. It was doing well. It's always nice to see that. And if YouTube is gonna be ridiculous and send out the bots, well then I am going to make a very dramatic YouTube thumb and title and use those same bots and the way the algorithm works to hopefully get this video out there again so people can see it. Because again, I think it's solid and fun, and one of the things that I really enjoyed was hearing people say that they were thinking of checking out the series now. Comics needs more people reading it and checking it out, and more people to talk about and have fun with the hobby with, and it was fun to see that happening. And so it's very sad to see that just cut off so arbitrarily. And in all fairness, I was up here anyway because I had to pose dramatically for another thumbnail that's coming up, for a video that's coming up soon. So thank you for listening to me ramble. If you watched that original video and you think, like, no, I know what the 18 plus was, please let me know. I want to know. If you're new and this is your first time seeing it, I hope that you enjoy the video and leave me a comment and let me know what you think. I'm gonna take my salt and apply it to other parts of my life now. I'm out.
Call me flatline, like the one you're about to have.
New characters, they're always popping up and trying to pop off. The question always is, who will stick around? And the answer can usually only be given by time, and sometimes lots of it. Sometimes characters who seem fit to stick around can burn out. Or you can have characters who've been spinning their wheels for decades suddenly pick up because of a good storyline or a good creative team. Those don't have to be the same thing, it can be different. Sometimes just seeing the potential is enough. There are many reasons to create new characters. For fun, to boost up our roster, story necessity, dreams of lucrative IP, and that's just to name a few. Whatever the reason for their conception, characters tend to fare better when they possess certain attributes. Or rather, when they have certain components. A credible reason for being around, i.e. part of the story. An interesting personality slash backstory. A unique relationship with the main character of the book, or the potential for one, and room to grow. And then that can spread out to other characters as well. A good design is also very important. Now, having all of these things is a surefire way to have a winner. But if you have a couple, you can also hit the ground running. So with all that in mind, we're going to take a look at Flatline, aka Nika. A character who arrived on the scene prominently in the Robin solo series, the one helmed by Damian Wayne, entitled Robin, which began in 2021. I'm Sasha and this is Casually Comics, and it's time to see if Flatline can jumpstart. There was supposed to be a heart joke in there, but it didn't really happen. I'm very distracted by trying to make sure that there's less glare today than there was in the last video. There is less. These glasses are trying to take over the world and give me anime villain eyes. Flatline first debuted in Detective Comics 1034 in 2021 in the backup story Demon or Detective Part 2. She was created by Joshua Williamson and Gleb Melnikov. It's very much a cameo appearance. She's a photo on a view screen showcasing the contestants who are going to be in the League of Last
Lazarus tournament. The Mortal Kombat one happens on another island, I guess. You have to be older for that one. The first time you see Flatline do anything is in Robin number 1 under the same creative team. This series, when it comes to Damian's overarching character growth, is about him finding his place and being comfortable being himself, hence the whole demon or detective. It's about him trying to emerge from both those shadows, and in the process he'll loosen up and learn to have some fun. Now the latter is not a new plot at all when it comes to Damian. It tends to be a go-to if his personality has been in any way reset, which means at some point he's been brought back to base. And his base is arrogant, abrasive, presumptive, impulsive, and sometimes a know-it-all.
With some secret vulnerabilities to be found underneath.
Which are quite the cocktail to mix together and have the character still come out likable. Many have tried, few have succeeded. But of course, on the receiving end, on the fan side, mileage varies. So at the start of this series, he's very confident in his abilities. In all fairness, part of that arrogance is earned. He just wants to hurry up and get the tournament underway. Snap, snap, just let him defeat everybody and then he can go home. This is where Flatline first comes in.
Call me Flatline, like the one you're about to have.
I was trained by some of the greatest fighters to ever live.
And I was trained by some of the greatest fighters to ever die. Absorb their defeats and learn from them.
Flatline very quickly bests Damian, ripping his heart from his chest. Fatality. Which is not only a nice image, but she is holding his heart in her hands. This is going to matter multiple ways later on. One of which is romantically. This is foreshadowing. This is foreplay. This is meant to be the start of a kind of romance between the two, or at least the start of their chemistry.
Miles varies on this. For some it landed, this little kind of first crush story. Others found it very forced or rushed.
This series does push Flatline a little bit. It clearly wants her to be a part of Damian's ongoing supporting cast. But unlike, say, a Punchline, for the start of this, she's confined to one book. Although in all fairness to what happened with Punchline, she was thrown into an event that was taking place across multiple Bat books, and so they just kept putting her in the various other books where the event was tying in. They did give her too many fighting skills, though. Flatline is on the cover of issue 2, which is a cute cover. There's a strong amount of confidence in her design. It's very Hot Topic goth girl. She even has little coffin clips in her hair. People hear Hot Topic and they automatically shy away, but some of the clothes there are nice. Some of the looks are nice. I know I can feel the comments incoming, but if that's the aesthetic that people want to go for, and then you can also market it, so you're kind of killing two birds with one stone, and the design is in keeping with her name, and also with the fact that she's Lord Deathman's protege slash sidekick. To me, it's a cute design. It works. It's eye-catching, merchandisable, and cosplayable, which is factored in these days. And again, keeps her on theme. Yes, Lord Deathman making a comeback. We've covered him here on this channel before. I don't know why I flipped my hair for that. Flip your hair for Lord Deathman. He's much closer to his portrayal in the Bat manga here than his original Silver Age one, or the New 52 one, but it is tying lightly more into his Rebirth one. But you don't need to know any of his history for this to make sense. All you need to know is that he can't die, he's got regenerative abilities. Also that he's zany and over the top, and dramatic. Flatline very quickly establishes an interest in Robin. She doesn't take killing him personally at all, and has a very different attitude towards death than most. The first hints of her backstory are given in issue 6, where her and Robin are bonding over examining the fighters in the tournament trying to pinpoint their weaknesses. They also bond a bit over Damian's love of manga. This is one of the things that's been given to him in this series to kind of give him some of his own things that separate him from some of the other Bat kids. It's also supposed to soften him, because here he is this killer, but actually he really likes slice of life romance manga.
Before this, his thing was having lots of pets and loving animals, but that seems to have fallen off.
The book he's reading is cleverly used to illustrate some of the things he's seeking in his personal life. Like some of the things he's missing, so he's getting it vicariously through this manga. There are things like friendship and a little bit of romantic interest. The romance is hinted at because you see a panel of the two main characters interacting and kind of bonding in that way while he's talking to Flatline. It's good. I like that it's a romance about an art school, but also about being competitive. Lord Deathman is super weird about manga for some reason and tries to keep it away from me.
Were I even working with Lord Deathman? Is he your father?
God, no. I just sought him out. All my life, I was drawn to death. Being born with the power to absorb the skills of people as they die might have had something to do with it.
Why they always gotta put the mutilated doll on the floor?
Sometimes it's just a phase you go through. We get a cliff notes about how her family didn't understand her. How they felt that she was broken, so she fled and sought out Lord Deathman. Because he can't die, he seemed like a good person to learn from. Someone who could train her and she wouldn't have to worry about, you know, well, killing him. And he eventually sent her out to the tournament so that she could learn even more skills, because she would get them if she killed them. Because whoever dies on this island is resurrected. Because it's called Lazarus Island. There's a big Lazarus pit underneath it. The part about why she's there is only partially true.
Lord Deathman can be weird and a frustrating instructor, but he's gotten better recently. That's crazed. Sometimes I think I'm really the one training him.
Flatline ends up as part of the entourage on the island that Damian eventually ends up calling friends, and is part of helping him defeat the big bad of the island, which is a demon rising from the pits. The secret real reason for the tournament, because they needed deaths.
Also, Ra's al Ghul's mom wanted to summon it. There was a whole evil mom plot.
And Damian has to learn that it's okay to ask for help. They even have a whole sequence where they kind of redo Bruce's origin when the bat flies through the window, and they make it seem like, no,
It wasn't just the bat that made him Batman. It was ringing the bell to call Alfred and ask for help, because despite always working alone, Batman's always actually worked with other people.
The power of friendship! Damian really has been reading a lot of manga.
In issue 11, the two end up sharing a kiss.
Which was no surprise. One of the covers, it was issue 7, was even a will they, won't they tease. It had little plushies of the two of them. It was a cute cover.
And so often everything I do, or am, is a piece of something else. My mother, or my father, even being Robin, but the manga, that's mine. Does that make sense, Flatline?
Nika, my name's Nika.
Bringing victory.
You know, we're tied, right? I killed you, you killed me. We need a tiebreaker.
I think we both know who would win.
Yeah, we do.
Kissing sounds, mwah mwah mwah, smooch smooch smooch, all the kissing, look, their heads are making a heart, cute cute cute.
So they do have a moment here, but they're not really boyfriend or girlfriend. They do make some jokes about that later on. It's just a connection that they've shared on Lazarus Island. And what happens on Lazarus Island stays on Lazarus Island until it doesn't and becomes a massive event that rewrites the entire DC universe. But really this is just meant to be that these two have a special connection. Flatline is presented as a relaxed, open, and confident person. But she also did say she was on the island to learn how to live because so much of her life revolved around death, which in some ways matched up with Damian's backstory. They're compatible, basically. He had been raised to be an assassin. He was surrounded by abuse and trauma. Damian has a very cold, angry, and distrustful look on life most of the time, while Flatline is a more optimistic person despite her ability also allowing her to see all the things people have done, including the fact that her own grandfather was a serial killer.
Well, I mean, an assassin. Bit of both.
Flatline is given an expanded and slightly modified backstory in the Robin 2021 annual. Now she's shown as being from Russia and having a morbid interest in death from a young age, but her hair has yet to turn white.
Did you know Grandpa was a serial killer?
Yeah, here's the thing with Flatline. She's meant to be a bit of that blasé cool girl. She has a she-doesn't-care-what-anybody-thinks attitude. She just says what people are thinking. Sometimes it works, and sometimes it doesn't, and the balance can be off. And she can come across as a bit of a caricature because of it. Never showing deep emotional responses to anything, no matter the situation. It's fine for her to be more positive and less rattled by things, but to show zero reaction can leave her feeling like a two-dimensional side character, rather than what they are trying to build her up as, which is a more established side character, perhaps even a serious part of Damian's cast. She finds a jacket with skulls under it under her grandfather's bed and is also communicating with his ghost at the funeral, who says that he has the same powers that she does. They were part of a KGB experiment. They skipped a generation and they've come to her. He says that because of these abilities, he became an assassin and now she will have to fight. And she does, because some enemies come to the funeral, and so she takes them out and she gains even more skills as she's doing it. So her power set is used as a way to explain her skill level, which is clever. And as she battles, her hair turns white. Because it does. All that death, I guess, just turns your hair white. Her family are terrified of her, so they flee and she's left on her own.
They were worried I was too obsessed with death, even as a little kid. Turns out it was in my blood all along. After I discovered my abilities, I tried to travel and find other dead killers to learn from, but too much time had passed. The deaths had to be fresh for me to absorb their skills, their knowledge, and experience. I felt lost again. I needed to talk to someone who understood death, who could see what I see. That's why I came to you.
It's not just because Lord Deathman has the best chair. Look at it. She doesn't have to work very hard to convince Lord Deathman to take her on as a sidekick, particularly when she says that, hey, Batman has a sidekick and this makes him more like Batman. Sold. This catches us up to how she came to be in the tournament and also gives her a bit more of a detailed backstory. It does change a little bit of the context, what was revealed in number 6, but it doesn't change it too much. In issue 12, it's revealed that she kept Robin's heart to bring to Lord Deathman, who she is loyal to, but their relationship is played as a joke a lot, and it can be a very funny one, but that flippancy that they constantly add to Flatline makes her hard to predict. Sometimes it comes across like she's morally gray and makes her kind of exciting, and other times it comes across like she's just being written to do what the plot needs her to. One of the things she is definitely supposed to be is funny. This is achieved by her quipping a lot. She is too cool for school.
Dude, your mom is such a badass.
A surprise drop with a bunch of ninjas in her all-white suit? Boss.
Hey, real talk. Does your mommy a sidekick? Hey, you know this whole town is about to throw a rager. Since we all survived a death tournament thing, I say we get down.
Look at the hawk in the back there. He's like, I have nothing to contribute to this conversation. These attempts to make her character hyper cool don't always work to her advantage. They can at times fall flat and give her a greetings fellow kids vibe or a stereotypical girl boss vibe. When the jokes land and the balance is there, it works, but other times it takes away from far more interesting characterizations. Now the jokiness makes sense because this character and this book are meant to be a bit more lighthearted. Flatline isn't a person who takes all that much too seriously, which is fine, but when that becomes something that
occurs all the time, it can make the situations themselves appear less serious, or make it feel as if the character herself really shouldn't be given that much thought. And she can have some deep moments. There's some really good ones when her and Robin face off again, and now they have a better connection, so she has to convince him a bit that no, this is fighting, their relationship is separate from what they're doing. As mentioned, Robin was not the darkest or heaviest book. It was aiming for a more fun tone, and was happy to play in tropes. I mean, Death Fight Island. But when it came to some, it could lean in a little hard. It went for very sitcom-style jokes about their relationship.
When you're done with your makeout session, we can compare notes on what Mother's Soul and this tournament are really all about. It's not a makeout.
Of course, for those whom this type of humor resonates, the character and the book will be rendered more endearing and enjoyable.
Don't worry, I won't tell anyone I snuck up on you.
Check out my new look. I told you that your mom was my idol, right?
Team Talia. Lord Deathman said you turned into a monster.
That guy, he has this whole criminal empire that he never actually uses, right? So I took over. People here were afraid of him because he can't die, but their fate's worse than death.
Look what?
I just baby-proofed everything.
Drove him nuts.
Girlfriend, have you been telling people I'm your girlfriend? Moments like this, while I do have a bit of a chuckle factor, are a bit of a double-edged sword.
Flatline taking over Lord Deathman's turf, be it seizing it or as part of a very rushed ruse, doesn't necessarily make her more hardcore,
because you never really see her have to struggle or see how she goes about things. It just makes her feel a little flat. Flatline has a reason for her skills, so she's not overpowered in that capacity. But she's also been given an impenetrable zero vulnerabilities personality and is rendered virtually unstoppable. It makes her harder to relate to and can weaken the character rather than strengthen it, if you're looking to get some kind of long-term investment going, and not just a surface level, oh yeah, Flatline was cool, that was fun. This is too bad because there are some really nice moments with her. Her and Damian bonding over just enjoying regular things, given their background, is a nice moment. The idea that she's surrounded by death all the time, to the point where she has a hard time relating to life, even though she's a very upbeat person, is also an interesting one.
Just also side note, her slang is a bit out of date.
Team Talia, is Twilight popular again?
I know people still say that on occasion, but not that much, not out loud.
Type it somewhere. I'm out of date too. Watch people come in and be like, we say team all the time, but I'm not trying to write the hip youth. On the whole though, Flatline is fun. And she introduces cute potential dynamics when they're not overemphasizing them. Damian tends to play better when he has someone who doesn't take him too seriously and is more positive to riff off, like Dick or Steph or John and now Flatline. There are also some credible seeds here as to why they would like each other. Flatline can understand him and he doesn't need to hide any of his darker self from her, and he can also just be himself in lighter ways too. No need to put up a front. While Damian is someone who won't be threatened by Flatline or find her idiosyncrasies odd, they also have some conflict built into their base personalities, without it being forced. Flatline doesn't take most things in life too seriously, has shifting allegiances, and can be very self-focused. Those are problems when paired up against the very serious and, despite appearances, connection-driven Damian. So they have strong interplay potential. Banter is fun, it just needs to not be overplayed. However, some may feel the balance is great, and some feel not every character needs to have all that complexity. Let Flatline be the flippant, too cool for school deaf girl. She doesn't need to be more than that.
But she could be, though.
I can see it. Also, some are just tired of the darkness and grit. The time of recording seems to very much permeate a lot of comics. So just to see something that's taking itself a bit less seriously and just trying to present a fun story with fun characters, maybe a breath of fresh air. Learn to relax and love the manga, like Damian. Now, this comic did end at issue 17. So the ending did have a bit of a wrap it up, hurry up vibe. A lot of things have ended and are gonna be relaunching because they're kind of softly rebooting the universe again. There's gonna be a big Lazarus thing going on. Some things are just coming back. Some things got demoted to miniseries, and some things are just gonna kind of vanish. Issue 17 has some moments that were clearly meant to be a bit more, like it was meant to be more of a betrayal when Robin finds out that Flatline kept his heart and delivered it to Lord Deathman, and also that she was apparently playing him a little bit.
Your new little friend doesn't care about you. Flatline was working for me. She used you.
Okay, so he's telling the truth. I did use you at first, but I totally stabbed him in the back the first chance I had.
But we have to wrap it up fast so Lord Deathman gets his heart ripped out, because this series loved that. I can't say I blame it.
I'll teach you to lie about me.
Once I get you back home, you'll wish you could die.
They actually do some cover bait with Flatline here on Batman vs. Robin number 1. There she is. She's not in the issue though, but Jakeem is. Yay, Jakeem. Time of recording, that's where we are with Flatline. And that's her origin, 2022 edition. I mean, since the universe is about to have a big shakeup, we'll see what wackiness ensues. Hopefully it is wacky and not just tiring. Flatline is a fun character, has potential to either become a solid supporting character or be squandered and rendered quite irritating. Or of course forgotten or just fade away. Those are always options too. She worked well for Damian's Robin series, and it remains to be seen how she'll do outside of it. Damian Counter is one of his friends now, so there's that. He doesn't have that many, so that's special. But now I want to hear from you. What do you think of Flatline? Is she interesting to you? Do you like the design? Did you find her funny? Are you feeling the light romance with her and Damian? Do you think she has potential? Yes, answer all those things. I want all the answers. Share your thoughts down below. While you're down there, please do all the YouTube things. Like, share, comment, subscribe, and hit the bell notification so that you never miss a vid. Thanks so much for taking some time out of your day to spend it discussing comics with me. I always appreciate it, and I will see you again soon. I said that so slowly today. Okay, bye-bye.